Philippines gets the lowest spot in Bloomberg's COVID-19 resilience ranking.
Philippine Senator Risa Ontiveros accused of bribing a Senate witness to testify against Pharmaly Pharmaceutical.
The fighting Senator Manny Pacquiao retires from boxing.
And a chain of hospitals in Brazil accused of testing COVID medicine on patients without their knowledge.
Good evening, I'm Karen Davila.
And I'm Ron Cruz.
On our broadcast tonight, a disappointing distinction. The Philippines is branded as the worst place to be in amid the pandemic as it drops to the bottom of Bloomberg's COVID-19 resilience ranking. But the palace believes global vaccine inequity is to blame. Rafael Bosano has tonight's top story.
The Philippines ranks last in a list of 53 countries on Bloomberg's COVID-19 resilience ranking. The business news giant says the country is working with an inadequate testing regime as it grapples with an outbreak of the more contagious Delta variant. Bloomberg says stronger testing would allow the Philippines to better detect outbreaks. It also says vaccines should be targeted to populations most at risk from COVID-19 to prevent fatalities. Malacanang, for its part, is not surprised the Philippines ranked last, while more developed countries like Ireland, Spain, and Denmark are at the top. The palace explains vaccines are key to defeating the virus, but rich countries are hoarding the jabs, while poorer nations wait for trickles. The health department admits data on breakthrough infections remains lacking. The data that they need come from communities.
Meron naman po kami nakakalap na datos for these breakthrough infections. Our hospitals are helping us. They give us information regarding these breakthrough infections among our healthcare workers. But we still need information coming from our communities.
The past days also saw the fast rise of asymptomatic patients. Based on latest data from the health department, asymptomatics account for 16.4% of active cases. But just like how the DOH exercises caution in affirming the decline in cases, it also remains careful in pointing to what is causing the rise in numbers of asymptomatics.
Pinag-aaralan natin yan ngayon, and we would like to also see if yun pong mga paggamit natin ng ibang methods din ng pag-test have an effect, no, on this increasing number of mild and asymptomatic. But our number one assumption would be the vaccines are working for all of us.
Despite the observed decrease in cases, healthcare utilization rates in many regions remain high. The answer to this disparity is what the DOH is searching for.
We have 94 areas in the alert level 4, kung saan ang ibig sabihin niyan, more than 70% ang utilization ng ICU nila. Wala po tayong area na nasa alert level 1. Ang ating alert level 2 ay less than 10 areas lang. Alert level 3 ay nasa mga 20 plus. So ngayon po, hindi pa namin masasabi na accurate na bumababa because of all of these factors that we are observing.
Rafael Bosano, ABS-CBN News.
The Philippine government aims to begin the vaccination of 12 to 17-year-olds by October 15. The health department says children with comorbidities and other immunodeficiencies will be prioritized. Pfizer and Moderna vaccines will be used. The government also plans to start vaccinating the general population by the end of October.
Senator Risa Ontiveros denies allegations she bribed a Pharmaly employee to testify against the firm. Ontiveros says the witness reached out to her camp and they vetted the information provided by the witness. Ontiveros says she is ready to face any charges that will be filed against her. Ferdinand Topacio, the lawyer of detained Pharmaly official Lincoln Ong, released a video of a Pharmaly employee who claimed a warehouse staff was bribed by the camp of Ontiveros.
Ang importante rito, money change hands. According to the witness, it was given by a member of the staff of Senator Ontiveros at ang nag-ibot ay driver. It is not our place to say that whether this is true or not. Our place is to bring this to the attention of the proper authorities and for them to conduct an investigation. And if warranted, file the appropriate charges against Senator Rizo Ontiveros.
It's official, boxing legend Senator Manny Pacquiao is hanging up his gloves, but he is setting his sights on the biggest fight of his political career. Pacquiao announced his retirement from boxing through a video posted on his Facebook page. He thanked everyone who helped him in his boxing career that spans more than two decades.
It is difficult for me to accept that my time as a boxer is over. Today, I am announcing my retirement. I never thought that this day would come. As I hang up my boxing gloves, I would like to thank the whole world, especially the Filipino people, for supporting Manny Pacquiao. Goodbye, boxing. Thank you for changing my life. When my family was desperate, you give us hope. You give me the chance to fight our way out of poverty. Because of you, I was able to inspire people all over the world. Because of you, I have been given the courage to change more lives. I just heard the final bell. Tapos na ang boxing. Maraming salamat po sa inyong lahat.
Pacquiao's retirement comes a month after his loss to Cuba's Yordanis Ugas for the WBA super welterweight title. He recently announced his 2022 presidential bid.
Despite nixing a presidential run in 2022, Davao City Mayor Sara Duterte Carpio still tops a presidential preference survey. But as RG Cruz tells us, her father, President Rodrigo Duterte, is no longer the leading contender for vice president.
In the latest nationwide Pulse Asia survey from September 6th to the 11th, 2,400 respondents were asked to pick from a list who they would vote for president at the time of the survey. 20% picked Davao City Mayor Sara Duterte Carpio, down from 28% in June. 15% picked former Senator Ferdinand Bongbong Marcos Jr., followed by Manila Mayor Isko Moreno, Senator Manny Pacquiao, who gained 4 points from the survey last June, Senator Grace Poe, Vice President Lenny Robredo, Senator Ping Lacson, and former Speaker Alan Peter Cayetano. Senator Christopher Bongo was among the laggards in the survey. This was after Duterte Carpio bared August 25th that her father confirmed plans for a Go-Duterte tandem and left her with requests to either endorse that tandem or get Go to be her vice president should she run for president. The survey was also more than halfway done when Duterte Carpio announced she won't run for president because she and her father agreed only one of them should run in a national election. Pulse Asia President Ronald Holmes explained, while Duterte Carpio's August 25th announcement was captured in the survey, her September 9th announcement had not yet sunk in at the time of the poll. Holmes says Duterte Carpio's lead isn't that significant, considering the margin of error.
Well, it's not too significant a margin. It's about the percentage point away if you apply the margin of error. One out of five do prefer her, and there are other contenders, three contenders who are in the double digit. Not that far. And if you look at, for example, yung level of approval of the administration, in the past, you had the president really getting significant majority.
Holmes, however, dispels notions that a united opposition under one candidate would beat the administration candidate in a one-on-one match.
Maaring yung botante ng isang opposition, maaring bumoto din siya doon sa kandidato ng administrasyon. Kung nawala yung kanyang pinapaborang kandidato na hindi nasa administrasyon. So, nahati rin yung boto.
Duterte Carpio's spokesperson relayed the mayor's gratitude, stressing that the survey numbers show the people's clamor for a stable leadership. Pacquiao's camp isn't surprised he rose in the survey. Senator Lacson doesn't see any need to change their strategies. Roberto's office thanked their supporters for her high trust and approval ratings. Senate President Vicente Soto III overtook President Duterte in the vice presidential race. 25% picked Soto as their first choice. Only 14% picked the president, a far second. Holmes attributes this to Soto declaring his vice presidential bid early on, aside from his being a longtime senator and showbiz personality. Soto also leads the Senate, which has been investigating the Duterte administration's use of COVID-19 response funds, which has been marred by allegations of corruption. Holmes notes the survey already captured the effects of the Senate investigation and the president's defense of Farmally. Thanking his supporters, Soto vowed to work harder to be a worthy candidate for vice president. Presidential spokesperson Harry Roque belittled the survey, insisting that the president is still the candidate to beat. At the senatorial race, broadcaster and social media personality Raffy Tulfo and former Speaker Alan Peter Cayetano led the 15 people who stood a chance to be in the winning circle, which is dominated by re-electionists and returning senators, including Francis Chise Escudero, Loren Legarda, Bam Aquino, Juan Miguel Mig Zubiri, and Francis Kiko Pangilinan. RG Cruz, ABS-CBN News.
The Philippine Commission on Elections approves the extension of the voter registration period for the 2022 polls. The extension is set on October 11th until the 30th to give way for the filing of certificates of candidacy on October 1st to 8th. Registration of overseas voters is also extended for 2 weeks until October 14th.
A unanimous decision to extend voter registration. As with any planning, meron talaga tayong slack time, no? Meron talagang ano yan, may allowance talaga yan. Basically, what this means is we're gonna dip into that slack time.
Some groups hailed the ruling of the Philippine Anti-Graft Court ordering a bank to pay the government millions worth of Marcos' ill-gotten wealth. But as Mike Navalio tells us, it remains unclear how the ruling will be enforced.
The recent Sandigan Bayan ruling ordering a bank to pay the Philippine government almost 100 million pesos and more than $5 million worth of Marcos' ill-gotten wealth is a welcome development for some human rights advocates, and it couldn't have come at a better time. In the midst of a possible run by Ferdinand Bongbong Marcos Jr. for the presidency and repeated denials of plunder during martial law by the Marcoses and their loyalists, the ruling, according to a lawmaker, is proof the Marcoses stole money from Filipinos.
Certainly this debunks the revisionist narrative of the Marcos loyalists, no? The Marcos family and his cronies did not commit plunder and had no ill-gotten wealth, no? During the time that the dictator was in Malacanang, no? Very clearly, this foreign judgment that is now being recognized by the Sandigan Bayan is proof that when the Marcoses fled to Hawaii, no, dala-dala nila million, hindi lang million, billion, 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 no, na cash and other proof of funds that they plundered, including these bank certificates from the former Traders Royal Bank.
Several other court decisions here and abroad declared the Marcoses had ill-gotten wealth, including a 2003 decision by the Philippine Supreme Court which said the Marcoses made judicial admissions of their ownership of $658 million worth of deposits in Swiss banks. In 2018, Marcos matriarch Imelda herself was convicted by the Sandigan Bayan for funneling $200 million in the 1970s to Swiss foundations. Since the Presidential Commission on Good Government was created, it has recovered 174 billion pesos or $3.4 billion of ill-gotten wealth, which included luxury buildings in New York and jewelry. But Sarate believes there is much more.
And we have to continue pursuing this, no, because at the latest data provided to us by the PCGG, ang na-recover pa lang talaga natin, no? Sabi ko nga halos ano na 35 years after EDSA, 174 billion pesos, no? Or roughly $3.4 billion. And according to some records, more or less $10 billion yung na-plunder ng Marcos family and his crony. So we have a long way to go to recover all this ill-gotten wealth.
The Marcos family has declined to give any comment, but it has repeatedly denied plundering the country's coffers during their patriarch dictator Ferdinand Marcos's 20-year reign. But the question now is how to enforce the latest Sandigan Bayan ruling. Traders Royal Bank is no longer a bank. It amended its articles of incorporation in October 2001, changing its name to Royal Traders Holding Company Incorporated. It also deleted banking from its operations. In November 2001, it sold more than 10 billion pesos worth of assets to the Bank of Commerce, and the Bank of Commerce assumed more than 10.4 billion pesos in liabilities, excluding the claims of the Philippine government against TRB. The agreement was declared valid by the Supreme Court. The Sandigan Bayan, in its latest ruling, cited this agreement to absolve the Bank of Commerce of any liability. In a statement Wednesday, the Bank of Commerce reiterated the contents of the agreement and emphasized that it is a separate legal entity from the TRB. ABS-CBN News checked with the Securities and Exchange Commission and was only able to retrieve the 1999 financial statements of what was still the Traders Royal Bank. Among its directors is a familiar name to the Marcoses, Roberto Benedicto, the chairman of the board. The Philippine government had claimed the Marcoses owned more than 278,000 shares of TRB through Benedicto, Marcoses' close friend and classmate. But the Sandigan Bayan said there was no sufficient evidence to prove the Marcoses owned the shares and that these formed part of his ill-gotten wealth. Mike Navalio, ABS-CBN News.
Coming up, the Republicans in the U.S. Senate block yet again the Democrats' bid to extend the suspension of the U.S. debt ceiling.
And a hospital chain in Brazil is accused of testing unproven drugs on COVID-19 patients without their knowledge. The World Tonight returns after the break. Tonight, the U.S. government is at risk of shutting down after Republicans in the Senate once again blocked a bill which would raise government borrowing limits. This report.
Republicans in the U.S. Senate again blocked a bid to raise the federal debt ceiling on Tuesday, sending Democrats scrambling to avoid a government shutdown and a potentially crippling default. Borrowing authority is set to run out next month, and federal government funding is set to expire on Thursday, leaving lawmakers little time to avert a shutdown, which could leave hundreds of thousands of federal workers unemployed. Senate Republican leader Mitch McConnell reiterated on Tuesday that Democrats should be responsible for lifting the borrowing limit themselves without GOP support.
There is no chance, no chance, the Republican conference will go out of our way to help Democrats conserve their time and energy so they can resume ramming through partisan socialism as fast as possible.
Meanwhile, Democrats insist that some $5 trillion of the nation's debt came from Republican President Donald Trump's time in office. The standstill over the debt limit brings an additional challenge for Democrats, who are already at odds over President Joe Biden's trillion-dollar infrastructure package and an even larger social spending package. A government shutdown or default would be a huge blow for Democrats ahead of next year's congressional elections.
A lawyer for whistleblowing doctors in Brazil claimed a hospital chain tested unproven drugs on elderly patients infected with COVID-19. The full story and more in this report.
Whistleblowers in Brazil accuse a local hospital chain of testing drugs on elderly COVID-19 patients without their knowledge. The lawyer of the whistleblowers told Brazil's Senate the tests aim to validate so-called miracle cures preferred by President Jair Bolsonaro. Nine people died due to COVID-19 during the trials, but their charts were altered to hide the cause of death. Brazil's health ministry has yet to comment on the allegations. U.S. air carrier United Airlines says it will fire nearly 600 employees who refuse to get vaccinated against COVID-19. Last month, United became the first U.S. airline to require COVID vaccinations for employees. It says more than 99% of its 67,000 U.S.-based employees got the jab. Over in France, the traditional la bise, or kiss on both cheeks, is making a comeback. It was discouraged at the height of the pandemic, but with more than 70% of the population vaccinated against COVID-19, people have become more comfortable with close contact. But some Parisians say they have become more selective with who they share this kind of affection with.
The PSE index outperforms most Asian peers after staging a last-minute bounce. Michelle Ong reports.
Most Asian markets under pressure yet again as rising U.S. Treasury yields flag inflation concerns. Gold also nearing 7-week lows. Trading Edge's Ron Acoba explains rising yields are bad for risk assets in the very short term.
Any rise in yields would not only be detrimental to equities, but for companies in general, because precisely borrowing costs for companies and even consumers would tend to rise as well. On the valuation end, now an increase in yield would also lead to an increase in discount rates. Specifically, the increase in U.S. yields would also lead to an increase in the valuation of the U.S. dollar, which we saw as of late, the U.S. dollar to the peso exchange rate jumping to 51 from just 50 a few days back. As you know, any sudden jump in the U.S. dollar to peso exchange rate would trigger some degree of foreign selling.
For the day, the PSE index gained 0.75% to close at 69.34, inching ever closer to the key resistance level of 7,000. In corporate stories, Visman developer Cebu Land Masters broke ground on its 3.1 billion peso Mantra Residences in Mandawa City, with 90% of Tower 1 of 3 already sold out. This prompted the company to launch its second tower by October, ahead of schedule. Mantra Residence is managed by Cebu Land Masters in partnership with Isidore Holdings, headed by former Aboitiz Group Chairman Edamon Aboitiz. Michelle Long, ABS-CBN News.
Our final word for tonight is a quote from Steve Maraboli. Life doesn't get easier or more forgiving. We get stronger and more resilient. And that's the world tonight, the 29th of September, 2021. I'm Ron Croz.
I'm Karen Davila from the Philippines. Thank you. Mabuhay.